Clinical neuropsychology. Already in 1908, there was a paper on the eye movements of patients with schizophrenia, and they could show that the ocular movement, in particular smooth pursuit of patients with schizophrenia, are substantially different from controls. Namely, they can't make smooth pursuit. It's jagged. It's full of saccades and unsmooth patterns. This was then forgotten for 70 years until Hoffman in 1973, and this is from his paper, showed the same thing. And it has then been showed again and again and again. It's very systematic result. So strong that in Meta Review from 2008, O'Driscoll and Callahan said that average effect sizes and confidence limits for global measures of pursuit and maintenance of gain place these among the very strongest measures in the cognitive neurosciences. I think this shows eye movements are really important in the neuroscience. And add to that the fact that if you ever feel dizzy and you will go to a hospital, something's wrong with your balance maybe. What do? They check your eye movements. Eye movements are so connected to the whole neural system that many issues with the brain can be studied by simple eye movement tests. The second large success of eye movements is, of course, reading research. And research has been interested in reading for a very long time. And already in the 19th century, about 150 years ago, they found that reading is not smooth. We don't move our eyes smoothly or just, which today may seem obvious, but say, they didn't know that. You can't see on someone's face that they are making fixations as a card to the text. With this, it started a series of eye-movement research that was summarized already in 1898 in a book by Hermann and Dosch. Where they formulated several hypotheses, such as the visual span, the idea that when you're locating your gaze on a word, you can only see a bit to the right and a bit to the left. They call this the visual span, and outside of that, you don't take up anything. And there was no way in the 1890s to test this. But in 1975, because of computers and technical development, Keith Rayner, in his PhD thesis, could lock the case to the presentation of the text so that text was only visible where you looked, and everywhere else it was crossed out. And when you made the count, the text followed, the clarity of the text followed as a window. And he could measure the size of visual span by seeing how small he could make this window of text before it affected reading. And it turned out that it's about, let me see now, it's about 10, 12 characters to the right and about 4 to the left. And since the 1990s there have been even computational models, computers that simulate fixations and saccades of the text fairly well. And I think it's fair to say that no other research field has published so much eye language research as the reading researchers. The third success story is much newer. It was not until in the 1980s that it was first possible to control a computer with your gaze. That is, to look at menus on the computer and select items simply by looking at them. And this here is another system. It then developed, especially about 10 years ago, there was an intense research put into the possibility to control your computers by gaze. And today, you can, if you want to do it, you can buy an eye tracker that you set up in front of you, and you can turn on and off your television set, you can answer telephone calls, you can turn off and on the light in the room, anything you like. You can write emails. Books have been written even by gaze alone. And this is, so far at least, not something that everyday people use. I mean, none of us are using gaze to control our computers. But for people with disabilities, say they can't control any muscles below the neck, but they can still control their eye movements, then this is what makes life practical for them. And I think the fourth success story must be understanding the system that controls eye movements. And people have spent a lot of time thinking about this from the mid 50s and up until today. There are essentially two groups of researchers who have worked with this. One group looked at the psychological determinants of eye movement. Why do we look at certain places and not at others? Is it brightness? Is it motion? Is it contrast? Is it sudden onset of light? And why do they attract our attention? Or is it things like task? And is there a difference between people who can spend time on the task versus those who are attracted by sudden onsets? So that's one line of research. And the other line of research looked for these mechanisms in the brain. And they would typically insert electrodes in the brain, not on humans, on monkeys. But monkeys have, the visual system of monkeys is very similar to that of humans. And when they inserted electrodes in certain parts of the brain, the monkeys suddenly made a saccade. And when they inserted it in other places, they could inhibit the saccade. And by doing this meticulously, they have found a very intricate control system in the brain for making fixations, saccades, smooth pursuit, for inhibiting, for controlling the timing of eye movements. And, part of it is located in the back, reflexive saccades are located back, tasks are located from here, timing is located from here, and it's all sending signals down to the superior colliculus, which summarizes the control of saccades and sends it to the brainstem to the eye muscle center, which launches the eye movements. So we now know very much about both these things, both what makes us look at certain places and what systems in the brain do this. The early researchers used eye trackers that look like this. I suppose you've seen modern eye trackers. I'm just pointing out that those who worked 100 years ago, their eye trackers were more difficult to use. For instance, at the top here, that's from 1898, they used plaster cords that they put directly onto the eye and suspended it into a string like this with a stylus on a paper. So when the eye moved, the stylus moved, the paper moved slowly upwards. So it drew the eye movements that you made them. Delabar in his paper mentions that he only measured on himself, and before he applied this plaster coil, he anesthetized his eye with cocaine. This eye tracker here was used by Buswell in 1922. Buswell made longitudinal reading studies, but he also examined how people look at the pictures. And here, the participant doesn't have anything attached onto the eye, but she is stabilized in the eye tracker, so she can't move much else than the eyes. And there's an infrared lamp here that is reflected in her eye, and when she moves her eyes, the reflection moves a little bit. And it's led into this drum here. There's a photosensitive film in there. The drum turns slowly, and the image of the reflection is recorded there. And these people, they write in their papers that it took them months to analyze a few seconds of data. Right. That eye tracker up there, to the right, that was used by Jarbus, Alfred Jarbus, the Russian researcher, who published his book in 1962. He was really interested in fixation stability. He had ideas about this in the 40s and 50s. But what he's known for is face perception and the role of instruction, that instruction gives different instructions, give very different gaze patterns. And he recorded with this eye tracker, which is also a corner reflection eye tracker, but it's it requires that you lift your eyelid and attach it up so that you have good view on the eye. This eye tracker was started produced in the in 1973. Of all these eye trackers, this is the only one that is still being used. And it's a really good eye tracker, but you have to sit still like this. And much of the reading research that was made in the 80s and 90s were made by this research. Also the studies on attention and saccades were made with this eye tracker. Right, so here are some of the things people were doing back in the days. So after the, I've given you this historical background, because what happened then was that people took studies that were repeated and they made paradigms out of them. So a paradigm can be understood as a cluster of recurring design and analysis choices that people make. And in iMoment research, many of these have been given names. I'm not really sure why. I think people who create a paradigm, they want to name it and after themselves. So others have been given things like boundary paradigm, visual world paradigm, flicker paradigm. A paradigm often consists of trials that are repeated many times. There are iMovement measures, what we call dependent measures that you take from the eye tracker. Fixation durations of saccadic latency, or there are hundreds of them. And instructions that are given to the participant. So I think it's good to know these paradigms, because a lot has been done and people have not ready solutions, but they have ideas about how you can structure experiments when you do iMovement research. And this makes a lot of things easier. Implementing the study, communicating, replicating, analyzing, a lot of things become easier if you reuse a paradigm rather than designing a study from scratch. There are some issues possibly with paradigms. It can trick you into recipe following, where the recipe may not be the one that you need. And you may forget to think critically about your own research needs. So, with that, I think we can look at the first paradigm, the preferential looking paradigm, which is also known as the forced choice paradigm. It has been used since the 70s, essentially, but in the beginning they did not use eye tracking. So they usually use this with babies, infants. So the infant is sitting here, and they have two pictures, and they want to know which picture does the child look at first, and how long do they look at each of the pictures. Right? Before they had eye trackers, there was a student hiding under here and taking note of the gaze of children. But nowadays, the eye trackers are good enough so they can track children's gaze. So they use this a lot in infant research, often with habituation. So they teach the child a meaning of a word or a construction. And then they show a number of this of images and play the word, and then they see, do they look more at the word that is being spoken? In that case, they understand the word, right? And this allows them a way to see if young children, infants, down to 6 months, maybe even earlier, can understand parts of language long before they can speak it. It's not only used for infant research, though. It's also used for preference studies. The idea is that if you want to study people's preferences, you show them two things, and you see what do they look at first, and for how long do they look at it. And it can be used to study any kind of preferences. It has been used quite a lot in food preference studies. If you want to study how people think about different kinds of foods, you simply present them and see, is there a statistical difference in how early and how much they look at design. Right. This is the anti-saccadic paradigm. It is a simple, ingenious little paradigm where you give your participant a cross and then you tell them, I'm going to show you something on one side. It's going to appear there, But I want you to look in the opposite direction. That's quite difficult, right? Because we are, our brains are made to make us look at things that suddenly appear. So we need to inhibit that and instead go the other way. It requires focus and concentration, inhibition. And well, there are a number of measures of this. This often happens. People go in towards the target that appears, and then halfway they change and go back the other direction. So when we do this, we measure how many correct trials do they make. That is, how many times do they go in the way they are told to go. What's the latency? We know that the latency of going in the right direction, that is away from the target, is much higher than towards the target. So this pattern tests prefrontal control versus parietal cortical reaction. Small children are lousy at this task. They completely fail. They make 10-20% correct trials. And the reason for this is that small children, they are not very task-driven. They are driven by external stimuli. I'm sure you've noted this if you have a small child and you're, say, 5 years, then you are on your way somewhere, you're in a hurry, and this child finds a lot of things, and look there, there's another thing, I don't have time to go, I'll pick this up. And this can be tested with very simply with this paradigm, the ability to inhibit distractions and focus on your task. It's been used to study children on advertisement on the internet. As you can guess, advertisements are exactly that kind of distractions that are sensitive to our ability to inhibit. But also many clinical groups have difficulties with this task. Here is an applied task, the distractor paradigm, that's also sometimes called the dual task paradigm. It's used a lot in traffic research. Here are two examples. The left one is a driver doing something here with the music. And on this side, this is one of our studies. It's a bicyclist who is answering a text message on the phone. And you measure how long do they look away from the task of traffic. It turns out, I think that's quite interesting also, that a driver who looks away 1 to 1.5 seconds, already there, they lose situation awareness and they are in a risk to start drifting to the side of the road. But a bicyclist can go on for 10, 20 seconds with their on the phone, and it doesn't seem to be a risk. I found that quite interesting. Visual search is one of the big paradigms of eyeballment research. And visual search, there's always a target. There's always something you want to find, and you know what it is. You just don't know where it is. And we all do this sometimes. We walk into a room and there's something we want to find and we look around, but we don't find it after. Or if we are we're at the train station, there's someone we are going to meet and we are looking around among the people. We know what the person we're going to meet look like, but where? That's visual search. And there's been quite a lot of visual search, and they often formalize it like this. Here is the target. It has this, it's directed this way, and it's black. And this searcher, who happens to be a monkey, looks at black first. So this shows that this monkey prioritizes color over direction. There is a whole bunch of measures that you can use if you're doing visual search. And it's a useful paradigm. If you have a target and you have distractors and you want to find the target, then visual search is the method to use. This is another kind of visual search, of course, but it's still the same, right? There is a target that we want to find, and there are distractors. And the same thing goes on airport, of course. Right. Scene perception paradigms often show scenes of some kind, and there's no particular target to search for. They call it free viewing, and often the task of the interest of the study is to see what information are we looking at. And it turns out that as soon as there is a face in a photo or an image of any kind, then people look at the face early and a lot. Other than that, it's task-relevant objects. If there is a task, people look at task-relevant objects. And if they don't have a task, then they look at bottom-up things like onsets and contrasts and edges, things like this. And they've also asked, is gaze driven by bottom-up stimuli or task and semantic objects? And it depends. They've also looked a lot into the question what is the function of the fovea versus the periphery? Because when we are tracking the eyes with an eye tracker, of course we are measuring what the fovea is directed to, but the whole periphery is still there, and it does important stuff for us. For instance, finding the next fixation target. They have also asked the question, why is there a central bias? It turns out if you show photos, or anything really, people tend to look in the middle. And we're not really sure about why. But it's also the case with if there's a billboard or something, even if it's not in the middle, and people gaze towards it, they look in the middle. And we're not sure why that is. Possibly because it's good to look in the middle, because then you get maximize your visual input. The looking at nothing paradigms, they are often structured like this. You have something, you have an image to look at, you're told to memorize it, and then you remove it, and then you show something blank, a blank screen, and then you ask people to recall the content of the image. And what almost always happens then is that they start to move their eyes as if the image were still there. When they pick up the image and record it. And this is a way to study mental imagery and memory, at least visual memory. And this happens irrespectively if you show pictorial, spoken, or textual encoding to them. So any type of information they pick up, they do this. It turns out that people who are poor at spatial tasks, they make more of these image movements. It's also the case if we instruct them not to move their eyes, then their recall is poorer. Which shows that these eye movements are functional. They are useful for our memory recall. Uh, Here's another infant paradigm, the clouded motion paradigm. This is about anticipation. So there's a little face here, and it moves around the circle like this. It's up there, and it's going to disappear behind the black rectangle. And we now have an infant looking at this, and they will follow the face, of course, because it's a face. But the question is, what does it do? What does the child do when the face disappears behind the black rectangle? Do they look here, or are they confused? Simple enough. The visual world paradigm is a good eye movement paradigm for studying online processing of language. So what they do is they show an image. I think we'll use this one, it's a bit easier to understand. And then they play speech to the participants, like, the man will ride the motorbike. And if you're eye-tracking the person who's looking at the image while they hear this speech, when we say the man, they will quickly look at the man, and then they hear will ride the, and that's ambiguous, because the man could ride the motorcycle, but in principle the man could also ride the carousel. So we measure how many of our participants look at the motorbike and how many look at the carousel before we come here. Gaze is so fast that it's it will be on one of them before they hear what it is. Right? So we can measure that anticipation. And with the child, the girl, it will most likely be the opposite. Right? We expect more looks at the carousel when it's a girl. But we don't know. Now, the nice thing with this is that if you design your speech so that there are cases in there, or determiners, or anaphoric reference, then you can play around with the scene and see how do they process this. What are their anticipation? Can a case marker disambiguate the case? For this reason, I think this is a really nice paradigm. Here's a clinical paradigm, smooth pursuit paradigms, and they are slightly boring maybe, but you know, they, like in A, you move the target to the side and then it slowly moves like this. Your task is to follow it. This is a target that goes back and forth. And this one also goes back and forth, but it goes. And then they track people who are looking at it, and it's typically cleaned in groups. Like I already showed you this picture here. And they measure gain, phase, that is, how well do they keep up with the target. The number of catch-up saccades. There are catch-up saccades in smooth pursuit if you're lagging behind so much that you must make a saccade to catch up with it. And the finding is particular with people with schizophrenia is they don't do this well. Here's another clinical paradigm, the vestibular paradigms, and this is a very common paradigm in hospitals. So you take your participant, you let them sit on a chair, there's a cross on the wall, and they're instructed to continue looking at the cross, right? Then the The doctor takes the head of the participant and quickly turns it to the side. Now, if the participant has a functioning vestibular ocular reflex, then they will very quickly realign their gaze. But if they have poorly functioning vestibular ocular reflex, then it will take much longer and the eye will follow the head to the side before they make a return to the target. And this correlates very well with balance issues. There are other things that you can do with a vestibular ocular reflex, like you can turn the people around or have a drum around goes around, and then they will have optokinetic nystagmus, the eyes will go. If you have ever been in a train and you have looked at someone across from you who is looking out the window, then you will also see this. Yeah, it always happens when you have something that moves quickly beside the crowd. Or if you have, as a child, been sitting on the playground on one of those spinning chairs and you go round and round and round, then you also do this. But interestingly, what happens is when you stand up there and you feel that the whole world is turning, then this happens. The eye movements continue to go like this for about 20 seconds. Because the velocity of the turning is stored in the brain, and this storage continues to feed the eyes with the sensation that you're moving up to 20 seconds after you've stopped. And this is why we feel nauseous after a bit of spin. Right. Now I'm going to talk about reading for a while, because reading is really important in eye movement research, and if you're not interested in reading, well, you have the chance to learn something. Or, well, you see. So, reading research has, strangely enough, well, mostly psychologists, the good reading researchers, and they design their experiments in contrasting pairs, just like you should. So there's context, and then there's a contrasting pair. In one case, the word in the contrasting pair is expected. It's natural in context. In the other case, it's a complete surprise. Now, what do we expect in terms of fixations? Right. In the second case, when it's a very strange word there, of course we expect the fixation to be much longer. We expect them to stop there and say, oh, what's this? Surprise. This doesn't suit with the context I read. It should be here. Someone has... this is a typo, an error in the text. Now, so that's basically the idea behind research. So they do have measures for this. So first fixation duration is the duration of the first fixation on the word. It's supposed to reflect the lexical activation process. The idea is that when we look at the word, we have to find the meaning of the word, and we stay on the word until we have arranged that. It takes about 180 to 220 milliseconds or so for normally frequent words to be activated, and words that are really difficult to activate, then the first fixation duration will be longer. Unfrequent words that you see very seldom, then the first fixation duration is longer. Gaze duration is the total time that you stay on the word. It reflects how well you can integrate the word in its previous context. If this is an out of context, unexpected word, then gaze duration will be longer. And the probability of regressions. The going back and look at what you've already read to understand how the word you just read connects to what you read before. So these are the major measures that they are using. There are a few others. And then they ask comprehension questions now and then to make sure that they are reading for comprehension and not just moving their eyes over the text, which would undermine the whole methodology. Right, they have looked at syntactic structures a lot. I've done a little bit of reading research, not all that much, but I know from the reading researchers that the major time-consuming issue that they have is to control for frequencies and lengths of the words in the pairs. Because if they build contrasting pairs, the contrasting words should have the same length, and they should have the same frequency. Because frequency and length have very strong effects on eye movements. Yeah. So, and this leads, if you want to have, say, 20 sentence pairs with the same contrast in the words, then after a while there are no more words to choose from. And that seems to be the major issue for the reading researchers that I've talked to. Right. Reading researchers talk about early versus late measures. The early measures are those that deal with lexical activation, because you have to activate the word at first, the word meaning, before you do anything else with it, right? And after that, you can integrate the meaning with that of other words, which the late measure shows. They are also talking about local versus global measures. Local measures refer to things that happen at the point of manipulation in the text, whereas global measures are averages for the whole text. Which brings me to the other major paradigm of reading research, namely the text comprehension paradigm, which shows to participants full texts, like here. And it's not so much interested in the grammar and the syntactic structures or type of words, but it compares different readers and different conditions. This is how it all started. All the early studies were of this kind. It was only later that they started to do sentence processing. Right, so here are some average global measures of text reading. 210 milliseconds, 4 letters, 10% of the words are skipped, and 6% are regressions. And they have found that out fairly early. This is data from Basper 1922. No one else has really replicated this study, so this is what everyone shows. And I think this still holds. He recorded people from when they learned to read all the way up to university level and took global measures from them. This is the number of fixations per line. It reflects how long those saccades are. Right? If you have many fixations put on the line, then the saccades are short. And they start out with really many fixations per line. And this is because when you learn to read, you have to look carefully at the word. Perhaps you don't recognize it. You have to look at it many times before you can pronounce it and understand it. But this drops quickly as you learn to read. And in the fifth grade, it is at the level of an adult reader at university level. And the same goes for the fixation durations. After a few years, when they're around 12 or so, reading has established at the level of an adult educated reader, I think this still holds. The only thing that differs is the number of regressions per line. It continues to drop all the way to university level. And I think this is because regressions have more to do with the world knowledge than it has to do with the automatization of reading. Finally, there's applied reading, newspapers, textbooks, subtitles, music scores. People have been doing reading research on all this. They use other measures. These are the gaze-continued paradigms. Gaze-continued means that you change the stimulus depending on where people are looking. And there are several of them. So this is what Keith Rainey used. You can see the word around the fixation point, but everything else is crossed out. With this, you can investigate how much do you need to see in order to read fluently. And there are some variants of this. This here is also a much used paradigm. It's called the boundary paradigm. All right. So what happens is there is an invisible boundary in the text. When you're here and you start making the saccade, because we're blind in saccades, they change the word that you're going to land on. So when you're here, you peripherally see a word, but when you land on it, it's another word. And then they measure the first fixation duration. If you're surprised, then you must have picked up information from here, right? If you don't pick up information from here when you're here, then the fixation duration here should be the same. And this is a way to investigate what information is picked up in the periphery versus in the fovea. And that's the summary table of this. A lot of things are picked up in the fovea, but in the periphery, the word length, the orthographic coding, phonological coding, the very visual things of the word, they are picked up. But not much of the meaning. So, I was planning to show you an example of reading from a study that we made, but I don't have time, so I'm going to skip that. Instead, I'm going to go here and say, it's not always possible to reuse a paradigm. Sometimes you have to design your study from scratch. Actually, quite often. And when people do this, and I've supervised lots of master students and many PhD students who have been in this situation, it turns out that the most difficult thing they have is to think through the whole study all the way to the measures, dependent measures, and the statistics that they are going to use. So, after a while, I decided to make this image model to explain how I think they should be thinking. And what I think they should do, this is on the vague stage, right? You have a vague idea about the study you want to do. There's a theory, there's some layman thoughts that circle around in society. There are a few early papers. Maybe you made a pilot study. And all this gives you an idea of what you should show to the participant and maybe the instruction you should give. So then formulate that in terms of predictions and hypotheses. This also is troublesome for some people. And then take the stimulus that you have and draw the predicted eye movements on that stimulus. I mean, concretely, draw fixations and saccades on it. The reason that I'm telling them this is that then they can ask themselves, okay, what is most important to answer my hypothesis? Is it the movement direction or amplitude? Is it the dispersion or duration of fixations? Is it latencies? Is it the number of fixations of saccades? And then they can simply look at what they've drawn and get an idea about what measure they should use. And in our book, we dedicated four whole chapters to measures that you can look for, and encyclopedically doing this. This is the second edition of our book on eye tracking, which describes everything I told about here and much more. Generally, I think eye tracking is an extremely versatile tool. You can use it for almost anything that is visual, even things that aren't visual, like mental imagery and memory. You can still use eye tracking. There's a large body of paradigms that exist already. And there's always the option to freely design the studies. There is generally a certain learning threshold. It's good to learn about eye movement and perception. There are some tricky things, like it's not obvious that fixation always means attention, for instance. And you have to think a little bit about this. It's not always obvious that you only pick up things from the fixation point. You may pick up things from periphery as well. But there are things, the ways to think around that, to solve that, if you learn about it. If you're doing eye tracking, you need to learn how to process large data sets. That's just life, because a typical study with eye movements, it generates a million lines of data. You have to have a way to process that. And I use R, and that works well. You need to understand the experimental design. I don't think psychologists have a problem with that, but many other users of eye trackers have issues with this. It's good to be able to program a little bit. Yeah, and finally, the cost of hardware. They are becoming cheaper, so that is being better. All right, that was it. Thank you.